to Central. This is a programme about a television company, Central Independent Television. Independent because we're a public company within the Independent Television Network, and Central because our transmission area is the heart of England. The ITV network comprises 15 companies, and together we serve the whole of the United Kingdom. Central, in fact, geographically speaking, has the largest franchise area, and we serve a potential audience of 9 million viewers. To serve our region effectively, we have two studio centres in the Midlands. In the West Midlands, our production complex in Birmingham was custom-built 15 years ago. In the East Midlands, the centre in Nottingham is without doubt one of the most up-to-date and advanced television studios in the world. The Nottingham studios were officially opened by the Duke of Edinburgh on March 2, 1984. We produce programmes for the central region, for the rest of the ITV network, for Channel 4, and on a global scale for television networks worldwide. It's, in fact, not uncommon for a central production to be seen by literally hundreds of millions of viewers. To support this production effort, Central employs approximately 2,000 people. Well, those are a few facts and statistics. Now let's meet the people who work at Central. The working day begins at 5 o'clock in the morning. A provocative programme can boost the postbag by hundreds of letters. Down in the construction shop, the chippies are building sets for programmes, working from a designer's plan.
No, the shallow one. Oh, that one, the 10 by 10, yeah.
We keep a weather eye on other media. The morning newspapers are about to be delivered to producers and directors. In graphic design, the finishing touches are added to sets that will be on the studio floor within the hour. And then it's down to developing ideas and working on forthcoming series. Hundreds of pages of script have to be duplicated and collated every day. Wigs of every shape, size and colour. No prizes for guessing that we've arrived in makeup. Here, Sue Hansen and her colleagues from the cast of Crossroads are preparing for another episode of the series that three times a week takes 12 million viewers to the most famous motel in the country. To make up actors for a period drama can take hours, so a story set in the present day is less demanding. Many actors find a visit to makeup is good relaxation before the hustle and bustle of the studio floor. Central operates the biggest dual news operation in the United Kingdom.
Hello, Richard Hanson Evans here, Newsroom.
As well as the Birmingham and Nottingham newsrooms where the editorial decisions are made, we have news centres in Oxford, Stoke-on-Trent, Hereford, Leicester, and we've even got a base at the National Exhibition Centre.
Hello, Newsroom. Right. Yes, John. Yes. How big a fire is it? At the depot, the ordnance depot at Donington. OK, just hang on a moment. Debbie, could you see if we can get hold of a helicopter to fly over Donington, please? OK, will you stick with the story there? We're going to send a reporter from here, hopefully in a helicopter flyover. Keep in constant check with me. OK? Yes.
There were no serious casualties in the blaze, but in hard money, the thick smoke from the Command Ordnance Depot amounts to the biggest ever peacetime loss suffered by the British Army. A central camera crew was on the scene within minutes of the fire, ripping through a supplies warehouse the size of Wembley Stadium. The only consolation for the Army at the moment is the view that arson by terrorists is highly unlikely. Doug Carnegie at the Army's Ordnance Depot in Shropshire.
In Studio 2, they're about to record an episode of Crossroads. Working from the script, the lighting director has lit the sets.
OK, in 5...
4, 3, 2, 1, 0.
And...
In the studio control room, the director guides his team through a rehearsal.
Patience, wait till you know who to pull his finger out.
Who's got a trick up there right now?
Hang about, hold it, please.
Inevitably, there are problems to be sorted out, and occasionally the atmosphere becomes tense.
I don't think it's put the flag in.
That's what I mean. They haven't put it in, have they?
Scenes! We needed this set in for this scene, didn't we?
That's it. Read on the riot act.
John, there is still a shadow problem here, if we can be aware of that. Perhaps lighting can help.
Yeah, I'm sure we can.
It's my shadow here.
On the studio floor, it's the floor manager who's in constant touch with the director and relays information to the artists. Back in the newsroom, more stories are coming in and assignments are being handed out to reporters. Meanwhile, Bob Warman's checking out a story for Newshound.
Yes, hello. I'm just inquiring about this.
Once a week, Bob teams up with John Kane and Bob's dog Oscar for a roundup of happy and fun stories. That's the format for Newshound. And here's Oscar leading a sponsored walk in Sutton Park, which raised a lot of money for charity. Another programme with its origins in news is What's Happening. Teams of children representing independent local radio stations test their knowledge of current affairs in this fast-moving news quiz, hosted by Tommy Boyd.
And Ruth, it's you to go first. Who is to be Peter Parker's successor as chairman of British Rail?
Bob Reid.
Bob?
Bob Reid, I think he's a Viscount.
Is he?
Mum and Dad told me that.
Did he?
Yeah.
We've got 10 points for Bob Reid. Mm-hmm. Have a chat with your dad about being a Viscount when you get home, all right?
And Tommy Boyd's a busy man at the weekends with a show that's full of fun, surprises, music and stars. The Saturday show is live, but even with this mad ad-lib show, there has to be some planning. And here we see the presenters, together with the producer, production assistant and floor manager, discussing the running order.
Yeah, Tommy and I's in grandstand.
This is the grandstand.
You were there.
Right. I'd like to be a waitress.
A wireless. Hang on, TV. No, we don't read those letters.
Just wave them about. Had lots of letters.
Hello.
When they go into the studio on Saturday morning for a brief run-through before the show starts at 10:30, there'll be lots of children, a couple of pop groups, special guests, some of whom will probably be quite zany, and maybe an animal or two. So I think you'll see that some planning is vital.
Okay, on item three then.
Tommy and Isla in the throne.
Right, I think we can skip item four, Tommy and Isla in the throne, because we did do that yesterday, and that's just going into VT Montage.
There you heard the producer mention VT Montage. To explain that, we visit the videotape recording area. Some of the music and the more complex sequences from the show are pre-recorded on tape. Here, the director and videotape editor are selecting the best shots and segments from material that was recorded earlier in the day. Their brief is to produce a pacey and entertaining insert for the show.
On the Is It a Dream, we cut straight to the act with her, getting up with a saw, stuff around her.
Also, this is where any mistakes are edited out. Mind you, they'll probably be used on Dennis Norden's programme. It'll be all right on the night. Educational as well as entertaining is Junior Television Workshop, which is based in Nottingham. It has two main aims. First of all, it constitutes a core of young actors from which producers can cast in suitable programmes. Secondly, the group is a forum in which children and programme makers can meet and exchange ideas. The group is run by Sue Knott, who's delighted that 11 of the children have already appeared in the Drama Armour series, while others have had parts in the Magic Micro Mission and Murphy's Mob.
London.
Smoke.
Yeah, the underground. Can you stop me there a second? Still, that bit is a little bit fast, OK? In London, the smoke, the underground, they're sitting in the front row last month. We'll just about catch it, but just take it a wee bit slower, keep it nice and clear.
Producers often look in on the improvisation and technique sessions, and Junior Workshop holds open evenings when central staff are invited to see the children perform. Who's to say whether or not these youngsters have the talent, determination and luck to stay the course and succeed in the demanding world of show business? But at least they're being given the opportunity.
Right, stand by please.
Everybody ready?
Let's concentrate on this. Is everybody ready?
Okay, Dice, off we go. Cue mic.
Now the true professionals in rehearsal at the Theatre Royal Nottingham for the light entertainment series Summer Royal, hosted by Lionel Blair. An outside broadcast unit sets up all the necessary broadcast equipment, including a control room, in the theatre.
Let me know the wonder of all of you. Baby, I
Once again, a behind-the-scenes look shows the hard work and concentration that's vital all through the rehearsals and the dress run before a show is ready to go on the air. And this is what it looked like on the night. This is the Golden Rose of Montreux, one of the many awards that Central, still a young company, has gained. In all fields of entertainment, many prizes and awards have come our way. The Golden Rose was presented to Central for a celebration of dance called Dizzy Feet. Produced and directed by John Scofield, the award-winning Dizzy Feet. Bullseye is the popular darts and general knowledge game. Hosted by Jim Bowen, it's a show that's been born out of the popularity of televised darts. You can't have a tight script for a game show like this, but as Jim, who's at the sharp end, will tell you, a definite routine has to be carefully worked out in rehearsal.
£200 for the bullseye, and bonuses to be won if the dart player hits the subject chosen by his partner. What do you think, Mike? Who we want. Come on then, Alec. You're all going very well, all of you. You really are doing so well.
The scoring is not haphazard. Big prizes are at stake and the scores are closely supervised with the help of a computer. When you look around a television studio and you see all this high-tech equipment, it gives you an idea as to the level of investment that's needed to set up and operate a television network. The recently opened East Midlands Television Centre in Nottingham cost Central £21 million. And where does the money come from? Well, the lion's share comes from selling commercial airtime. Central isn't just a programme maker, but an advertising medium as well.
Next.
Commercial breaks are queued in from the master control room. This is the nerve centre. It's where all the programmes, commercials, trailers and announcements are knitted together to provide a continuous flow of programming for the viewer at home. Switching from one video and sound source to another at exactly the right time is the name of the game. A mistake like the loss of sound on a commercial can cost the company a lot of money.
This farmer is about to
During 1983, advertisers spent over £110 million with Central. This figure alone highlights the vital role Central plays in the advertising world. This commercial launched Dairy Crest's new product, Clover, to Central viewers, and they loved it. 20% of housewives bought Clover in the first 3 months of the launch.
Struggle, buddy.
I think he likes it. New Clover. It's spreadable, but decidedly chuckle, buddy.
At the other end of the scale, we have local advertisers. It was vital for the Redditch Development Corporation to have a successful shopping centre that would bring money and more jobs into the area. Following a campaign on Central, the Kingfisher Shopping Centre now employs 2,000 people, and last Christmas, well over 40,000 cars a week were arriving at the centre.
Redditch Kingfisher Shopping Centre. 150 big-name stores with easy parking all under one roof.
One stop.
Redditch Kingfisher Shopping Centre.
One stop shop.
Most commercials are made on film and later dubbed onto these video cassettes. The Independent Broadcasting Authority controls the content and amount of advertising you see on ITV. In an average hour, there's a maximum of 6 minutes of commercials, split between three breaks. And remember, independent broadcasting is completely self-supporting. No income is received from license fees or other public funds.
Fade. Take.
Yes, Bullseye, very popular indeed. And of course it originated from the terrific following that the real game of darts has had as far as the professionals are concerned on television. Indeed, here at the Butlins Grand Masters, the stars of Bullseye pay for big money. But darts isn't just the only sport that Central covers. Indeed, we've covered well over 100 different sports. So, as far as we're concerned, if it happens, we'll cover it.
And it's set point to McEnroe.
little encouragement from the American. And that's a fine one, and Greaves out of it again.
Are you fixed up?
Yes, I brought my wife. What do you mean?
I mean, actually, with
a game?
Yes.
Jimmy, you don't come 10,000 miles to lose.
You mean you can't get Jerry Ford to play with you?
Is that fact?
You're really in trouble.
It's getting a bit tight in there, but it's the witches in front, and down they go in a terrible heap.
Oh, right on the button. This fellow's not going to last long, though. It's all over.
Witt picking it on. Now Melrose.
It was in the late 1930s when a handful of viewers in the London area were able to see live pictures of the Derby and the Oxford and Cambridge boat race. Then World War II came along and television went off the air. After the war, one of the major milestones in television was the outside broadcast coverage of the coronation in 1953. The main cameraman in Westminster Abbey on that historic day now works for Central. In the 1980s, no state occasion, election, major sporting event, indeed no major event at all, is ignored by television. This makes our outside broadcast units vital to the service we provide. It's an exciting area in which to work, and our OB crews have some wonderful anecdotes to tell. Outside broadcast cameras spend a lot of time at sporting fixtures. At other times, they're on location for drama, light entertainment, and current affairs. Here they're in Leicestershire at Beaver Castle to record an edition of the business magazine programme, Venture. Producer of the award-winning Venture series is Graham Mole.
One of the most crucial points of all is that we involve our audience. I worked it out the other day, and I think about half the stories that we put on the screen come directly from the audience to us, saying, here I am, I'm doing well, we're dealing with a very volatile community. So we get a lot of stories that other current affairs programmes don't. You'll find in television current affairs, and it's a very sad fact, that mostly they look at newspapers, they follow up from that. What I hope we do is we get our own stories and newspapers follow that. And the viewer at home sometimes thinks, smashing, that's my story. We're not being arrogant. We're saying we're listening to the audience, we're taking up your suggestions, and this for us is quite crucial.
On the move again. This time one of Central's three OB units is on its way to a four-day assignment at the Royal Show, just outside Kenilworth. The Royal Show makes ideal television. Visitors from all over the world come to see the latest in farm technology, as well as the colourful events in the main arena. And for those who can't come, Central brings it to them. On a fine day, a show like this is a slice of English life. Central is there to capture the atmosphere. Show or exhibition where there are many thousands of visitors is an ideal venue for Central's public affairs department to meet viewers. On Central's stand, there's plenty of colourful information about programmes. Actors and actresses, news presenters and our notorious weather forecasters sign autographs. There's a wide range of literature to help viewers in our dual region get the best from Central. You can buy a Central t-shirt, sweater or jogging suit Members of Central's Public Affairs Department are on hand to answer viewers' queries face to face. It all helps to fly the flag. This display on Central Stand is all about public service announcements. These are 30-second items produced and presented on air free of charge by Central for over 100 different organisations who need tangible support within local communities. When the Independent Broadcasting Authority selected Central to operate the dual region serving both West and East Midlands, we needed to meet and talk to a lot of people. The company has been busy staging numerous receptions throughout the region. Our chairman, Sir Gordon Hobday, on the left, and Managing Director Bob Finnis welcome guests to an event where regional board directors, company executives and on-screen personalities can exchange views with local authority principals, community leaders and the local media.
Stanley Birchmore, Leamington Spa. My wife, Monica.
Hello.
Good evening.
Yes, nice of you to ask.
Glad you were able to come. Yes. Except in those little bits and bits.
Yes.
From civic to national government, our man at Westminster is Reg Harcourt.
Well, this is where Central's political coverage begins, at Westminster. This is where the members of Parliament put their awkward questions to ministers, where they raise their points of order, and of course where they make their heartfelt speeches. But quite often, it's what an MP says outside the debating chamber that makes news, and that's where we journalists come in. I'm down here a couple of days a week, sometimes, like today, to do interviews, but always, of course, to keep in touch with members, to find out what they're thinking about, what they're saying about the political issues of the day. We also have here a full-time lobby correspondent. He's Andy Grice, who used to work on a Midlands newspaper before he came down here to Westminster a couple of years ago. And it's his job to maintain a regular flow of information from Westminster and be in touch with our newsrooms in Birmingham and Nottingham. What are the regional issues that you tend to get time and time again from the MPs?
By far the biggest single issue is unemployment, because the number of people out of work has been rising in the West Midlands faster than anywhere else in the country.
Live news reports from Westminster are routed back to the Midlands via the communication systems of British Telecom. Another form of communication is a series that recognises the multiracial mixture of our audience. Here and Now is produced and presented by Zia Moyadin.
Here and Now first appeared as a late-night show in September 1980 and was the first programme ever to look at the arts, achievements and the problems of the ethnic minorities. And despite the recent appearances of other shows aimed at the minorities, it's still the only programme that looks at the arts and culture of all the different ethnic groups. Although the programme is about the minorities, it is intended that the whole community watches and enjoys the programme.
Going up to the microphone and going, ah, you may have seen some of these impressions before, but not in colour. And I went away, and I just kept coming up and doing different voices and different impressions. And they fell about because I'd never seen a black Frank Spencer before.
Over the years, we've looked at an incredible variety of subjects, from the problems of being black and gay to satirical cabaret, from the current plight of the gypsies to the Chinese community, and art, music, dance, theatre and poetry from almost every country in the world. And if it's stars you want, Here and Now has presented some of the world's top performers. Oh, those Turks.
Central's education department makes 9 series for schools television. Science, mathematics, English and health education are all catered for in a visual and sometimes light-hearted way.
Choosing spectacle frames can be quite a tricky business, but lots of people have to do it because lots of people need glasses. Many people need some sort of help for their eyes, right from childhood, and others, as they get older, will need help, if only to make reading the paper a bit easier.
We constantly evaluate the effectiveness of these programs by talking to school inspectors and teachers and by school visits when Central's education officer can discuss a program with the children.
And we had a look before we started, didn't we? There's somebody here who wears glasses, and Mr. Morris at the back wears glasses. What I'd like you to do just for a minute or two is have a think about what it might be like not to be able to see, because, of course, we all can see in this room. And have a think about the things that you might miss. We saw it on the television just now, didn't we? What is Braille?
It's like bumps. It's like little bumps that you feel, and the blind people know what it says.
Now, that's what we call stick and goose. That's your goose. Now, what we used to do, mind you, we didn't let his mother know, but we'd get a sweeping brush and cut about 5 or 6 inches off. So throw it off, and then trim the edges.
Ways with Words is an English series for 8 to 9 year olds. Here we're bridging a very wide generation gap with a group of children learning about the playground games that were popular at the turn of the century. Good Health is designed to show 8 to 12 year olds how to take responsibility for their own health.
Let's do it together. Have a big puff. 1, 2, 3. That's it.
Central's religious output includes Contact, a news magazine transmitted live from our Nottingham studios every week, and the Encounter documentaries, this one where Birmingham Deaconess June Osborne is comparing this temperamental candle flame to the love of God.
If you wait, I bet you, if you wait. Here we are. Hey. The light of Jesus can't be put out.
Documentaries take us all over the world. Films on nature and wildlife can be beautiful. Some reports, like John Pilger's film on the ice-cold war between Pepsi and Coca-Cola, are informative and amusing. When program makers take us to the world's trouble spots, the viewer can be left angry and disturbed. The highly praised documentary The Decade of Destruction was the result of 3 years filming by Adrian Cowell in the Amazonian jungle.
The Post's policy was not to draw attention to clothes by refusal, but sometimes the effect could be bizarre. Clothes diminish jungle men, making them slightly comic versions of ourselves. But they invariably seem to wear them when they walked off with their presence into the jungle. The Indians were genuinely trying to be friendly, but as their forests burnt, so their tension and distrust seemed to grow. To whom then should we attribute the blame when a year later, the Indian, now receiving the knife, shot by Anumaya?
Most documentaries are made on film. When the film has been shot, and as we've just seen, that can be in a hazardous part of the world, it's brought back to base for processing and editing. Then the reporter, director, and editor set to work in one of Central's cutting rooms. Later, the commentary, sound effects and graphics will be added. If you want a program to be placed in the archives, then film is by far the best medium. Videotape technology is developing so quickly that it's hard to predict whether or not material videotaped today will be compatible on the playback machines in the year 2050. But you can always hold film up to the light.
I was an RAF officer flying in many parts of the world, and it was only when I suddenly
stuck myself into an easy, I felt
We've seen that our cameras travel extensively. Nearer home, documentary series like England, They're England reflect life in the Midlands. Life is full of characters and the central region has more than its fair share. In the 1930s, a boy called Harry Wilcoxon dreamed of being a ballroom dancer, a high diver, a champion swimmer. But down the pit he went. Then years later, this miner became a clown, devoting all his energies to raising money for charity. Meet Mr. Splash.
And I start from back end of the diving board and just literally run. As I crash into water, the little boy, what were in the water, I'm going to rescue. He came to my rescue and brought me out. So that was the start of Mr. Splash.
Then there are dramatised documentaries like Baker's Dozen.
You got ticks again? If I do find anything here, I cut the bloody lot off.
Mum? 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 Mum, have you been eating too much?
What do you mean? Have I been eating too much?
Last night, outside your room, I heard you and Dad talking. You said to Dad for Red Jet Baker's Dozen.
Now, that would teach you to sit listening on the stairs. I'll get your dad to deal with you later, Katie! Go on, you'll be late for school. Get! You! Ah, bugger off!
The turn of the century and hard times for children in a Midlands town. During the same period, Edith Holden was able to appreciate and enjoy a very different aspect of life in Warwickshire during the early 1900s.
To sit on rocks, to muse o'er flood and fell, to slowly trace the forest's shady scene, where things that own not man's dominion dwell, and mortal foot hath ne'er or rarely been, to climb the trackless mountain all unseen, with the wild flock that never need a fold, alone o'er steeps and foaming falls to lean. This is not solitude. 'Tis but to hold converse with nature's charms and view her stores unrolled.
Central's careful blend of drama and documentary has brought The Country Diary of an Edwardian Lady to television. In the 1960s, the world's imagination was caught by John Fitzgerald Kennedy. 20 years after the assassination, it was Central, a British company, who told the story of the late president's 1,000 days in the White House. The world's press were eager to see a preview. Central's chairman, Sir Gordon Hobday, and managing director, Bob Phillips, welcomed guests to the launch of a film that was soon to be seen by millions of viewers throughout the world. Many viewers watched the final part of this drama on the night of the 20th anniversary of that tragic day in Dallas, in November 1963.
Mr. and Mrs. Nixon are resting. Accordingly, I am instructed to read from this telegram sent to Senator Kennedy by Vice President Nixon. I extend to you congratulations and best wishes upon your election. I know that you will have the united support of all Americans as you lead the nation in the cause of peace and freedom in the next 4 years. Well, that's it. Thank you.
That's it.
We earn an income from selling programs to television companies worldwide. And Kennedy has been an outstanding success, being sold to 65 countries. To date, Kennedy has won several awards, including the British Academy's Best Drama Series and the TV Times Special Award.
Thanks very much. We're accepting this on behalf of Central Television. They thank you, but we would like to make a special thanks, I think, to them. To Bob Phillips and Margaret Matheson, who made it possible, Andrew Brown, who was our producer, Reg Gadney, who wrote this wonderful screenplay, and Jim Goddard for guiding us through all of that. As Americans, we're often very jealous of the quality of British dramatic series, and it was a real treat for us to have a chance to work. So thank you for loaning us Central.
The lovely Blair Brown, who played Jacqueline Kennedy.
Actually, we've done one at the awards ceremonies with series like Auf Wiedersehen, Pet. Then there was the moving story of Walter, played by that fine actor Ian McKellen, and many other productions. And all from Britain's youngest major independent television contractor. Remember, we've been on the air since the 1st of January 1982. I'm sitting in the announcer's studio. This is where, at the end of a day's transmission, we say goodnight. In closing this programme, I'd just like to say thank you for watching Welcome to Central.